And it's not entirely clear to me if they're throwing the hook testers, or going after Bernie Sanders, or if they're booing me and the rest of the country. And it seems that Trump got a little spooked by it. A little bit of a reaction to Bernie Sanders.
I guess I have to do it myself.
Thank you. here.
Thank you.
got a lot of other stories to get to, so let's do it. Okay. Now, recently there was a little bit of a dust-up at a rally in Albuquerque, New Mexico, for Donald Trump. New Mexico has the word Mexico in the state title, so obviously things were not going to go well for Donald Trump. Now, of course, he claims, wait a minute, what are you talking about? That's not true. He's great with Latinos. In fact, he says it over and over, and we have it for you. Here's what he claims about Latinos and how much they love.
I will get more Latinos than anybody else.
Are you great with Latino voters?
46% with the Hispanics. 46%. Number one. With Hispanics.
I love the Mexican people. Well, he said, I don't know. Every viewer that calls in, they all love them. They love them. All Hispanic. They love Trump.
And, you know, the Latinos love Trump. And I love them.
I have thousands of Latinos that work for me right now.
I love the spirit of the Mexican people.
I employ so many Latinos.
I love the Hispanic people. I employ thousands of them. I'm going to have thousands of people that work for me standing up saying we love Trump.
I love them.
I'm Hispanic and I work for Mr. Trump. We work for Mr. Trump. Yes, Mr. Trump. We love you. We love you. All the way to the White House.
Every part of that video was uncomfortable, especially when he starts rubbing her sides. But from what I understand from Donald Trump, not only does he love Hispanics, Hispanics love him. In fact, of course, you remember the famous tweet on Cinco de Mayo when he showed him eating a taco bowl. This is so ridiculous. It hurts the brain to think about it. He said, "Happy Cinco de Mayo. The best taco bowls are made in Trump Tower Grill. I love Hispanics." Dude, the fact that you don't understand that you don't prove how much you love Hispanics by eating tacos might get to the core of the problem. Okay, and he can't help but put in a plug for one of his properties while he's doing it. Anyway, it turns out that maybe not all Latinos love Donald Trump after all, because in Albuquerque, this was the scene outside of Israel.
And I'm just watching this thing. Is this going to die out? It doesn't look like these are young people.
Yeah.
It's early at night out there compared to where we are. It's not in the middle of the night. And they're horsing around. There's some, I guess you'd call it violence. It's roughhousing right now. Look at this. It's showing off, really. And we'll see.
Now, they say that was violent. And apparently there were some fires and stuff, so I don't want to downplay that. No one should do any of that. And some of them were Latinos, we imagine, because they had the Mexican flag with them. Some of them looked as white as day. Now, there's another video on this. Let's show you that one, dude, to give you full context, and then we'll tell you Donald Trump's reaction.
Both possibly hurling rocks, breaking through the barricades, going up against the glass doors of this convention center. I'm standing next to a couple of people who witnessed some of this earlier this evening. I'm just curious, ma'am, you saw, you said you saw a car burning, or you saw some fires being lit out here?
Lighting fires out there with the Donald Trump signs.
They were lighting Donald Trump signs on fire.
And dropping them all over the road. He had to put several fires out, stomp on him.
And what happened, sir? You saw this happening and you jumped in to put out the fires?
That's what I did. I just jumped in and put them out, and they were screaming obscenities at me and just being obnoxious, and that's about...
Did it feel like things were getting out of control out here for a little while? This doesn't happen very much in Albuquerque.
Oh, no, this happens all the time in Albuquerque. Albuquerqueans love to protest.
What was it like when you saw this unfold?
When we walked out, we were confronted and ambushed by six people in masks asking us if we were Donald Trump supporters, and then they proceeded to scream in our face.
Bigots and all kinds of other stuff.
My favorite part of that video was, oh no, this happens all the time now. Okay, so now look, don't do any of this, right? The protest, great, I love the protest, do the protest. But don't burn anything, don't throw any rocks, don't accost any people. Look, all the times we've criticized Trump supporters for assaulting protests, don't do likewise. That's a terrible idea. Then you lose the moral high ground. We know that they're for violence because Donald Trump says it over and over again. Don't play into that same game. Okay, now, look, so he's got some issue to be upset, but what's weird is I thought the Hispanics loved him. So it's weird not to see that kind of love expressed in the streets. Not a lot of people show up with Mexican flags to say, go Donald Trump. Okay, obviously some Latinos in the country do, but not a lot. Now, his reaction
could have been, hey, look, we can't have the violence, that's outrageous and unacceptable, and I would have shared that. No, he had to get racial. He couldn't help it, right? I mean, those Mexican flies were like magnets to him, like, oh, must say something about it. So he tweeted out, the protesters in New Mexico were thugs who were flying the Mexican flag. The rally inside was big and beautiful, but outside, criminals. Okay, now this is about the 18th Association of Mexicans with Criminals. And now look, Mexican Americans are allowed to fly the Mexican flag. I've seen proud Jewish Americans fly the Israeli flag, and I've seen, you know, the British pubs in Santa Monica here in Los Angeles fly the British flag all the time. Now, I get that this is a different context. I'm not trying to excuse what happened here. But at the same time, Trump, who apparently loves Mexicans, can't help but go, Mexicans! Thugs and criminals! Right? But then he's a child anyway. Inside the rally, when there was a little protest that was not in any way violent, he couldn't help but mock the protester. He said, go home to mommy. And he's told another, how old is this kid? Still wearing diapers. Imagine Ronald Reagan talking about, saying to a protest, go home to mommy, you're still wearing diapers. He's a child. He's a man child. Okay. Now, again, further context, I'm trying to be as clear as humanly possible here. Police said on Twitter that at least one person was arrested and several officers suffered injuries after being hit by rocks. So to call the people who did that criminals is fine, right? To say that you love Hispanics and Hispanics love you back is not really true. It's a lot of pig Latin if you ask me. Okay, now, among the things that he's done recently to attack Mexicans outside of this, and outside of the Taco Bowl, and of course, the first thing he ever said in his first ever press conference was, these people coming in from Mexico are rapists and criminals. He's back at it now. And then there's his general treatment of Latinos overall when his campaign manager was asked if they would appoint a Latino or other minority or a woman as VP. They said, no, we're not going to do any pandering like that, so we won't be going in that direction. So it's inconceivable that any of those categories could actually have the best VP nominee. I mean, we'd only pick a woman or a Latino if we were pandering. Otherwise, of course, they're not qualified. Don't be ridiculous. And then Susana Martinez, governor of New Mexico, was often mentioned as a VP possibility, but she has said some words that were not super kind to Donald Trump. She didn't want to show up at his rallies, so now he's mad at her, and she's totally disqualified, and he talks about how she can't get the job, that maybe I should run for a governor of New Mexico. Then I can get it done. So another Latino he's attacked. And then recently, and we're going to have more about this in another story we're going to do later in the hour, but there was a judge who was ruling against him in the Trump University case for very understandable reasons, but here's what Trump had to say about that. We're in front of a very hostile judge. The judge was appointed by Barack Obama, federal judge. Frankly, he should recuse himself because he's given us ruling after ruling after ruling, negative, negative, negative. What happens is the judge, who happens to be, we believe, Mexican, which is great. I think that's fine. Really? Then why did you bring it up? Of course, the judge is American. He was born in Indiana. But if you've got someone with a Latino last name, I'm Mexican! Criminals, thugs, Mexicans. Oh, I love the Mexicans. I eat their tacos. I don't know why people keep saying I don't like them. I've got a pretty good idea. Okay. Now, let's move forward. I've got more Trump for you, news for you guys. This one is going to drive him crazy. He doesn't really mind being racist against Latinos. He thinks that helps his cause. This one he's going to mind. Now, I've been saying for quite some time that Donald Trump is nowhere near as rich as he pretends to be. In fact, I believe I was the first one who started calling him the supposed billionaire Donald Trump, because nothing really proves that he's a billionaire at all. I'm not talking about $10 billion, which he claims, which is laughable, as you're about to see, not remotely true. Right? But even Fortune and some of the others that have looked at his fortune, say the Fortune magazine looked at his wealth and said, well, if you give him every benefit of the doubt, he comes out to somewhere in the ballpark of $3 billion. Why would you give him every benefit of the doubt? The guy's a serial and proven liar. He'll lie within the same sentence. He'll switch his position. So no, I'm not going to give him the benefit of the doubt. And now, finally, others are going, hey, you know what? Maybe he's actually not that rich. To which I say, of course, of course. The guy went through 4 different bankruptcies. It's hard to come out a billionaire on the other side of a bankruptcy. So that those were for his businesses, and they weren't personal bankruptcies. But 4 business bankruptcies, that'll hurt you. Okay, so now let's dive into this story from Politico. They explain the beginning. Donald Trump claims a net worth of more than $10 billion and an income of $557 million. But he appears to get there only by overvaluing properties and ignoring his expenses. First of all, how funny is that? Even if you, again, give him every benefit of the doubt. Can you imagine I came out here, I'm worth $10 billion. I mean, my expenses are $11 billion, so $1 billion in the hole. But I'm worth $10 billion. No, that means you're not worth $10 billion. Of course you have to take into account expenses. What kind of a businessman doesn't understand that? Now, you'll see as we get into the breakdown here of the other comical parts of this. They explain Trump attributes the refusal of releasing his tax returns to ongoing audits, but there is no prohibition on individuals releasing returns under scrutiny by the IRS. The refusal has led to rampant speculation among Wall Street executives who have done deals with Trump that his returns would show surprisingly low income. Wouldn't be surprising to me, but I'm going to give you some quotes from some of those other Wall Street executives in a minute. They have it in the article as well. But let's get into the nitty-gritty here. The financial disclosure form lists assets worth at least $1.5 billion, but the ranges included are far too wide for an observer to determine anything close to a precise figure. So let's break that down, because there's 2 things in there. He's got assets that are in the range of $1.5 billion. They give these huge ranges. So it could be much more than that. It could be $500 million, $750 million, or $500 million, I should say, right? All the way up to 1.5. Second of all, that's nowhere near $10 billion. Now, how does he get to the rest? Well, a lot of it is, my brand name's worth a lot. It's worth billions. Who made that decision? Now, his brand name is worth something. That's true. That is a business reality, right? Because the main way that Donald Trump makes money is by selling his name. He doesn't build anything. People don't trust him to give him money because his business has gone bankrupt so many times. If he says, I'm building a building, the bankers go, good one, Donald, good one. You're not building a goddamn thing. We wouldn't give you a loan to do that, right? Now, he can build golf courses, which are relatively small. I'll explain that in a second as well. But no, what he does is, okay, oh, you're a competent business person. You can actually build a building. Great, you build it, and I'll sell you my name, and you can call it Trump Tower, even though I don't own it, I didn't build it, and I'll charge you $20 million for that. So his brand name was worth something. By the way, it might be worth a lot less now that he's insulted half the world, right? And half the world's population says we would not do a business deal with him under any circumstances. Okay, but obviously that is very ephemeral. So at most, in terms of his assets, he only has a $1.5 billion giving him every benefit of the doubt. Now, there are some other things that are also real, but overall, your assets are the most real. Okay, so now let's get into more details. Steve Stanganelli, who is a financial planner, quoted in this piece, says, and he appears to be reporting gross revenue. There's a huge difference between that and net income. What really matters is what you put in the bank. So when he comes out and says, oh, I got all this money, I mean, I got my assets, and then on top of that, I have $500 million here. And then you go, okay, but what's your expenses? Oh, I'm not going to tell you that, but I'm counting that as my money. Preposterous. No business person would ever actually say, I'm only going to count my revenue, I'm not going to count my expenses, and I'm going to say that that's what I'm worth. It's comical. This is all a house of cards. He doesn't have any of this money, okay? So it's not that he's insolvent, which although he keeps taking out debts, and the article also explained that as well. If you have so much money, why do you keep putting yourself further in debt? Now, there's some legitimate business reasons you might do that. Hey, I'm going to start a building, so I need some debt on the construction, but he doesn't do very much construction. And he's actually cash poor, as you'll see in a second, too. So the whole thing's a house of mirrors and a house of cards and all the different houses, other houses that are tricks that are about to collapse. Supposed billionaire Donald Trump ain't anywhere near $10 billion. I don't think he's near $1 billion. Okay, all right. So they go on to explain a big chunk of Trump's net worth figure comes from high valuations he bestows on his golf course properties. Trump values 9 of his golf properties at over $50 million for a total of at least $450 million. He values at least 4 at up to $25 million and a fifth up to $50 million. But golf course valuation experts say there is nothing in the report to support these lofty figures. The Politico article goes on to explain that those somewhat comparable golf courses could go to $5, maybe even $10 million. In fact, you're going to see here, even Donald Trump plays with the valuations of those. But wait, let me get this right. A lot of your money is in golf courses? Dude, you ain't getting to $10 billion with golf courses. You're not even going to get to $1 billion with golf courses, no matter how much you inflate them. Now, even Trump knows he's inflating them, because get a load of this. On his disclosure report, Trump lists the Trump National Golf Club in Westchester Country, New York, as worth over $50 million, but ABC News and The Guardian newspaper reported earlier this month that for tax purposes, Trump's attorneys at first argued the property was worth just $1.35 million before increasing the figure to $9 million. So, classic Trump game here. Oh, I'm super rich. Yeah, that property's worth $50 million. All right, great. Give me taxes based on $50 million. Oh, no. It's really worth anything, man. It's only worth $1.35 million. He gets embarrassed by that, and now he's running for office, and then he goes, okay, $9 million. We'll call it $9 million. Well, mostly true. None of this is true. He's not a billionaire. He's not. He's just, the reason he puffs himself up like this is because he makes a lot of money from selling his name. He has to get you to believe that he's rich so that he can be rich. That's the whole trick. So that's why he constantly lies about his wealth. The reality is, he is a terrible businessman. He's down to running a bunch of golf courses. Really doesn't, almost builds nothing beyond that. And just sells his name. And all of these reports of billions of dollars, all based on Donald Trump reporting himself. Okay. Now let's get to some of these hedge fund managers that were quoted in the piece. One of them says, I know Donald. I've known him a long time, and he gets under his skin if you start writing about the reasons he won't disclose his returns. You would see that he doesn't have the money that he claims to have, and he's not paying much of anything in taxes. Now, seems very obvious. And look, I told you this months ago, partly because I know some people who work in Wall Street, and I know others who have made deals with Donald Trump and lived to regret it because he went belly up and was a deadbeat, wouldn't pay them. And so the word on the street, on Wall Street, on Donald Trump is loser. Loser. Doesn't really have anything along the lines he claims to have. Another anonymous individual from the financial industry says, if he's swimming in so much cash for all his holdings, why is he selling this stuff to raise cash? He's landed to sell things to come up with a $7 million. You're telling me you have $10 billion, but you couldn't find a couple of million dollars to run a campaign or do something else that you needed to do? Now, I know not all the money is going to be liquid. I understand that. But for someone who's a billionaire, $7 million is lying around on your couch. Hey, meanwhile, he's frantically selling things to try to get the $7 million. Keep it real. Finally, we do have one actually legitimate estimate as to his wealth. Let's find out what happened there. Well, as they explain, estimates of Trump's net worth range from a low of $150 million to $250 million, asserted by journalist Timothy O'Brien in a 2005 book that earned him a libel lawsuit from Trump that was eventually dismissed. O'Brien sought Trump's tax returns as part of the discovery in that suit, but the records were sealed by the court, and O'Brien is not allowed to discuss them in any detail. So now that was from a decade ago, but the charges were dismissed, the civil ones, right? And, of course, just sealed his statements. He actually saw my tax returns. Under no situation can he talk about my tax returns. As we find out, you're nowhere near $1 billion. The more you find out about Donald Trump, the more you realize what a loser he is. He's not winning anymore. His finances are a mess. He's not winning with them. Everyone going forward, and by the way, based on evidence and facts, it's not like he has ever proven that he's even a billionaire. So if you're a real journalist, you should give him, take that into account and give him the title that he deserves. Supposed billionaire Donald Trump. If you want to be even kinder, you could say self-described billionaire Donald Trump. Because that is literal. No one has ever seen assets of Donald Trump provable in a tax return where it's over $1 billion. Poor guy. Only a millionaire. Only Donald Trump would cry about that. But it goes towards the mirage that he has set up here. Okay. Now, let's go to the libertarians. So over the weekend, the Libertarian Party had its convention. Some wild moments in the convention. But overall, they've got their leaders. They've got Gary Johnson as the head of the ticket. He's running for president, former governor of New Mexico. And then you've got William Weld. He's going to be his VP, former two-time governor of Massachusetts. They're both former Republicans, now Libertarians. Weld promised the Libertarian Party that he would be a Libertarian for life because they were questioning his loyalty to the Libertarian Party. And then you start to look at some of the polling and you begin to think, maybe these guys got a shot. So first let me give you some general polls. CNN Washington Post poll says, another national poll showed that 44% of registered voters would want a third party to run against Trump and Hillary Clinton, the likely Democratic nominee. So 44% is saying that they want a third party. That's a big, big number. Well, fairly unprecedented in modern times. Now, they didn't say Libertarian Party. We're going to get to that in a second. Now, you go to a Monmouth University poll. Now, this is just for voters in New Jersey, but it gives you some snapshot. They explain in a head-to-head contest, Clinton currently has the support of 38% of New Jersey registered voters, and Trump has the support of 34%. Another 11% volunteered that they will vote for a third party or independent candidate, even though the poll question did not include that option. So that 11% number, again, is amazing. They're writing it in. No, I don't like these two people. I want a third party. They're like, we didn't even ask you that. No, I'm telling you, I don't care if you ask me. I want a third party. And by the way, New Jersey's deeply blue. When we're talking about presidential elections, and I can't remember the last time New Jersey voted for a Republican in a presidential election. Hillary Clinton only winning by 4 points. Okay. Now, then they finally asked, hey, what if we put Gary Johnson in there in the Libertarian Party? And in this case, they also put in Jill Stein of the Green Party. So this is, again, just New Jersey registered voters. 37% then go to Clinton, 31% to Donald Trump, 5% to Gary Johnson, and 4% to Jill Stein. 4%. That's a sizable number for Jill Stein, but Gary Johnson doing even better. But finally, we get to a national poll that does have Gary Johnson. In previous years, I've been covering politics for now over 20 years, right? That he's going to be at 1, 2% in the national poll at best. Partly because I just saw him run in 2012, and he got to almost 1% of the vote. Which is, you know, it's a decent start for a third party, but really not much to talk about. Get a load of this morning consult poll. 38% for Hillary Clinton, 35% for Donald Trump, 10% for Gary Johnson, 17% undecided. The undecided number is big. That Gary Johnson number is almost unbelievable. And look, if you're not knee-deep in politics, there's almost no chance you know who Gary Johnson is. I bet you of the 10% that said Gary Johnson, most of them didn't know who Gary Johnson was. They're like, Hillary Clinton? No. Donald Trump? No. Gary Johnson? Oh, okay, fine. That is a great start for the Libertarian Party. It's a great start for any third party. This election, this general election, you think it's going to be one person against another, Republican versus Democrat, like we've always had? Buckle up. I don't think so. I think a lot of people might come in. Here come the Libertarians, and they start at 10 points before anybody even knows who they are. That's an amazing start. You have to give them all the credit in the world. Now, what's the media going to do instead? Here they come. They're going to be dismissive. Like, this is just the tip of the iceberg. And I like Huffington Post, and I like a lot of their writers, including these guys, but not this piece, because it's a classic establishment media kind of, like, we're going to be anything, right? So, Sam Stein and Jason Chirkus write, but Johnson is also kind of an oddball, at least compared to other politicians. who is most at ease talking obsessively about his personal fitness. Now, look, to me, when I see, let me give you context, by the way. There are some positions of the Libertarian Party I agree with, anti-war, they're kind of anti-war, largely anti-war, let's be fair to them, right? Drug legalization, you know, you go down the list, things that, when they're actually in favor of liberty, right? Then there are economic positions which I find comical. Let's just give the rich even more. Let's cut all their taxes. Now, all might be a hyperbole, but not by much. So, trust me that I do not agree with the libertarians on at least half their platform, and aggressively so, right? But you got to give people their due, and you got to look at the polling and see for what it really is. 10% is a shockingly high number to start with. And what does the press start with? Like, oddball. Okay, well, and they continue. Here's another section of the article. How seriously do you report on a candidate who's climbing mountains as frequently as he's issuing policy papers? But wait a minute, guys. When Paul Ryan was working out with weights and all that, everybody was like, oh, look at Paul Ryan. He works out. Oh, good for him. You know, in good shape and looks good and all this stuff. Now, somehow you took Gary Johnson being in shape and being fit and used it against him. What an oddball. He's talking about how he's in shape and he climbs Mount Everest with a broken leg, which, by the way, is a little impressive. He might have some willpower to do that, right? And does these, you know, triathlons, etc. I don't really care too much about that, but it's a weird premise to say, like, I'm a weirdo. Why aren't you issuing policy papers? But you don't know that he's not issuing policy papers. He's allowed to be fit and have political positions. All right, if it was just one or two references, I wouldn't even brought it up. Here's reference number three. But Republican voters didn't see Han Solo because they were referring to an article where somebody said he looked from a certain angle like Harrison Ford. If they bothered to notice Johnson at all, they caught him flailing or making a joke about dog shit. Yes! Dog shit! Okay, that was from the 2012 race. Donald Trump made a joke about his penis size. I know Huffington Post also pointed that out, and so did the rest of the media, right? But that apparently was not a disqualifier. Here, he was flailing, and he talks about things he's not supposed to talk about. But yes, but the writers of this piece and the rest of the media, you're still not getting it. We're at a different moment in time. Yes, in 2012, Bernie Sanders wouldn't have done nearly as well. Donald Trump would have been laughed out of the race. Gary Johnson was in the race and got about 1%. We all understand that. But now, he's pulling at 10% instantaneously. That's amazing. It's not about Gary Johnson. It's about a phenomenon that you should be fascinated by and as investigative reporters look into instead of being like, oh yeah, last time it didn't work. Like, got you. Dismiss, 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 right? All right, look, last one, fourth reference now, that is dismissive and derisive. But while the 2012 campaign may have had its share of humiliations, his ego remains firmly intact for 2016. Don't do that. Give everybody their fair chance, look at their policy positions, but this is unfortunately a lot of times what the establishment does. We have decided in our infinite wisdom that some people are legitimate and others are not legitimate. And if we put you in the illegitimate category, then we will mock you mercilessly from day one, and it doesn't really matter how well you're doing the polling. We're coming for you. And we will never treat you with any kind of respect that maybe your new numbers actually merit. Part of the reason they do that is because they don't want non-establishment people shaking things up. I don't think the guys who wrote this are thinking that consciously, but buried in their subconscious is groupthink, which is Bernie Sanders, Gary Johnson, Jill Stein must not be allowed in the next. No, no, they don't think consciously must not be allowed, but unconsciously they're like, no, it can't be. Of course it's not going to be Bernie Sanders. Of course it's not going to be Gary Johnson. Don't be ridiculous. I dismiss him out of hand. By the way, you guys also dismissed Donald Trump in the beginning. How did that turn out? So there's two reasons why you got to correct your attitude. One, to do actual reporting. Okay. Two, you got to realize your establishment bias and realize that, hey, maybe the country's in a different mood. You might love the establishment. You might be part of the establishment, whether you know it or not. But the country does not love that establishment. They would like to change it. So they see Gary Johnson, they go, right off the bat. Some say, sign me up, and others say, I'm listening. And now understand, finally, that this is all very relevant. Because now the two parties control the debate stage. And they say you can't get on the debate stage unless you reach an astronomical number of a 15% in the polls. For third parties, that is historically incredibly difficult. And they put that bar there so that it could not be reached. But at 10%, they're almost there. I mean, they were certainly starting a conversation about whether they can reach it. And you've got two former Republican governors that even the mainstream media have to acknowledge, well, that's legit, right? So you got to knock those numbers down and create that cycle to make sure they are not allowed to get into the national conversation and tell people not to vote Republican or Democrat. Remember, bow your head. You must choose from one of these two parties. Well, that is not the mood the American people are in. And you can tell by their reaction to the Libertarian Party. So it's way past time that you guys take them seriously. All right, I got to take a quick break here. I come back. I've got to tell you one more piece about how the media is treating Bernie Sanders. So come right back.
We talk about TYT Army being so strong. Usually they help us run our show. Now they're going to help us run the country.
Oh, yeah.
Like this.
It's time that we reclaim democracy for the people.
We had a huge victory for Wolfpack.
When Lincoln said this is a country by, of, and for, he said of the people, not of corporations.
Our representatives don't represent us. Whoa! Democracy!
United!
We are!
We are!
Too strong! There's thousands of volunteers, and you can be among them.
With Wolfpack, the mission is so clear.
Money is killing our democracy.
96% of Americans want it.
When you get the power back, oh, that feels good. This is just the beginning. Let's go get them, man. Up and at them. Knock, knock.
We're coming for them!
Wolf-pack.com.
So let me read a couple of tweets for you guys. That Korean gal says, I love whenever Cenk uses Trump's own words to describe him. Oh, the irony. What can I say? He's not winning anymore. Okay, he's losing with his assets and his debts. Pixie Hack says, this is what democracy should look like. Referring to the libertarians and other third-party candidates. Many candidates, many ideas, choices, damn it. I hear you, brother. Okay. So, let me give you one more story for this hour. Over the weekend, I'm watching Reliable Sources on CNN, that's hosted by Brian Stelter, and they're having a conversation about whether the media did not take Bernie Sanders seriously enough and they've been too dismissive. So they've got three panelists on. You're not going to hear from all three. They didn't put it up online in its entirety. But I watched the whole thing. And there was one person from AP, Julie Pace, who you're going to hear from in a second. Then Jonathan Martin from New York Times, Michael Ruskies from NPR. And all three of them decided, no, we in the media rock. And the establishment media covered him just right. And he did not deserve that respect, basically. Now, look, I'm going to show you the heart of the conversation in a second. You'll be able to judge for yourself. But if you're doing a segment on whether the media treated Sanders and his supporters fairly, doesn't it make some degree of sense to have one Sanders supporter on? No, none. Wall-to-wall establishment media patting themselves on the back. Here, watch.
You look at all this and say, this is always what happens when a candidate is down on his luck and about to lose a primary and about to lose the race. Or is there some legitimacy here to the argument that this is still a competitive primary?
It is definitely true that the media as a whole underestimated him last year. But the reason that we focused more on him, that he began to get more attention, is because he started winning. Politics, presidential campaigns in particular, you hear a lot about momentum and the narrative and crowds at rallies, but really this comes down to math. How many states are you winning? How many delegates are you winning from those states? This Democratic primary, Hillary Clinton has a lead in delegates that is insurmountable unless Bernie Sanders is able to drastically flip superdelegates, and we have not seen evidence of that. So, I do understand that he is frustrated as he continues to win states, if not delegates, and he does see these big crowds. The math is the math, and that really is what this comes down to in primaries.
So the whole framing is wrong. So the conversation has started very late in the primaries, when, yes, Hillary Clinton has a fairly large lead, also among pledge delegates, let alone superdelegates. But so they get to frame it by saying, well, he's just down on his luck. That's one of your two options. He's that poor guy. So now he's going to start complaining. No, that wasn't the issue. The issue is, have the media treated him fairly throughout the process? Is that one of the reasons why he's not doing it? That help him do better? Of course, almost everybody would admit to that. But you're not just talking about math now, as Pace says at the end. Now, come on, this is about math. No, now it might be about math, and that might be a fair statement to make. But if the conversation is about how Sanders has been treated throughout, it wasn't about math on day one, and even she admitted that they did not take him seriously in the beginning. Media put the superdelegate count from day one. Not late in the process when math is the issue. You ring the math from day one by putting all those superdelegates up who do not vote until the convention. That was a gross act of negligence at best, by the way, if it wasn't on purpose, in terms of journalism. So, you don't know that, and you're the Associated Press, the New York Times, CNN, and NPR. That is embarrassing. If you do know it, and you know that the last close election in 2008, a lot of the superdelegates switched their vote. They said they were going to vote for Hillary Clinton, but voted for Barack Obama. Again, if you don't know that superdelegates switch their votes all the times and did it in the last close election, embarrassed. But if you do know that, and you haven't them from day one anyway. You told the audience from day one, Hillary Clinton is winning, Hillary Clinton is winning, Hillary Clinton winning, Bernie Sanders, don't worry about him, not winning. Then perhaps it wasn't the math at the end that's the problem. It was the fake math that you put in the beginning that was the problem. Now, look, we can and we have throughout the process documented that on the Young Turks. Whether it was the framing on different issues, including how the questions were asked during the debates, questions to the Republicans. What's your favorite drink? You know, how much do you love your wife, etc. And then you go back and look at all the questions they asked Bernie Sanders. You know, do you like socialist dictators in Latin America? Do you agree with them? I mean, on and on it goes. The 16 negative headlines by the Washington Post in 16 hours. NPR now saying, oh, ignore the polls. This was just from last week. Ignore the polls,
saying that Donald Trump has caught Hillary Clinton and that Bernie Sanders does much better against Donald Trump. So wait a minute, who's got the math issue if you're telling us to ignore the polls? Now, you can watch that clip from just last week about an NPR story. And what does CNN do in reliable sources? They bring on New York Times, Associated Press, and NPR, and have the CNN host all agree, oh yeah, oof, establishment media, we rock, big pat on the back. Should we hear from any Sanders supporters in a segment where we're discussing whether we've been fair to the Sanders campaign? Or anyone in the media that supports, forget surrogates. You couldn't find a single person in the media who supports Bernie Sanders? By the way, now obviously there are some, including us. You've got to at least try harder to find one voice who says, yeah, maybe you guys have been screwing this up from day one. But instead, conveniently, we got the establishment media saying, we investigated ourselves and decided, we nailed it! That doesn't seem to be the conclusion of the rest of the country. Young Turks.
A Rolling Thunder event. It is the annual motorcycle parade. Motorcyclists from all over the United States come to Washington, D.C. in honor of military veterans, and in particular those who are missing in action. This was a special year, however, because Donald Trump was invited at the last minute to give a speech. There were boos and cheers both when he was introduced.
And we just raised almost $6 million for the vets because I didn't do a television show. I said, let's do this. And we're announcing on Tuesday all of the groups that we put up this money, and we raise this tremendous amount of money because we love the vets, and that's going to be announced on Tuesday.
I volunteered for Donald Trump for several months and quite a few thousand miles.
I didn't even know he was here until I walked over here by the Lincoln Memorial.
Are you here because of Rolling Thunder honoring our military veterans and people missing in action, or because of Donald Trump?
Both of them, but mainly for our veterans.
Do you think that America is great no matter who the president
and the American people? We don't have that. We've lost that. We've lost our integrity around the world.
I've always been told that America is not like it used to be, and I don't know what it used to be because I wasn't alive yet.
Okay, so your elders told you that something's happened to make America less great?
Yes.
I just know that each day we're spiraling down further and further. It hasn't stopped.
Well, when did you first start to have that feeling that we were spiraling down?
When Obama was elected, I knew we were in trouble.
We did hear from some people who felt that politicizing Rolling Thunder, which is supposed to be a nonpartisan recognition of military service, that was inappropriate. This is Memorial Day weekend. It's not really a Republican or a Democratic holiday. Donald Trump criticized John McCain, saying that he wasn't really a hero because he was shot down and became a prisoner of war. Did that upset you?
No, absolutely not. I personally respect the fact that he was. He said nobody did less for the veterans than Mr. McCain. And he's the one that's running this, and he's running a number of veterans associations, so he will know best.
The level of information that people had on Barack Obama was limited because of the press. Now there's unbelievable amount of information to even incriminate him and get him out in impeachment.
What are some of his crimes?
Crimes? I wouldn't say crimes. I would say inactivity as far as leadership.
Well, you can't impeach the president unless he's committed a crime.
Well, what I'm saying is his, 930-some executive orders instead of communicate. The man cannot communicate.
I just like everything about Donald.
Cast member of the cable news story about whether the president was born in the United States or not. Were you aware of Donald Trump then?
No, I wasn't.
Do you think that the president was born in the United States?
The president we have now? No.
What gave you the surety to say that the current president wasn't born in the United States?
By watching all the news.
Do you believe that the president of the United States was born in America?
It's proof he wasn't.
I don't care. It was, you know, it was checked out by the federal government. If they say he was, it's good enough for me.
I haven't seen a birth certificate that says he has been born in the United States. I do know that he has family in Kenya. I find it hard to believe that his brother is in Kenya and yet he wasn't born there.
There's still controversy. One person saying he is, another person saying he's not. You need to show him proof.
Okay, so you still have doubt about whether the president is an American or not. So, with that right there would be an improvement. Donald Trump, you are convinced he's an American, right?
What, that Donald Trump is?
Yeah, are you convinced that Donald Trump was born in the United States?
As far as I am right now, yes, I am convinced.
Okay, and based on what proof?
I don't need proof.
Today's supposed to be about POWs, we didn't know he was going to be here.
Why do you suppose that so many people of color are against Donald Trump to the point where they're protesting even the existence of his candidacy?
You would be surprised if you look at the polls. Many African Americans actually voted for Trump, much, much more than any other Republican in the past.
So you don't accept the premise that communities of color are rejecting the Trump candidacy?
No, absolutely. And we're going to see it in November.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Damn it, they failed us. And if you know
it, it was genuine, but he was bad.
Jake Uger, known online as one of the Young Turks, isn't afraid to throw some punches.
3, 2, 1, fade up.
I just remember thinking, what is this guy's name?
Jake the Turk Uger.
What kind of TV station is this?
The whole point is for me to yell and scream and tell you what I think.
It's right out of like Wayne's World.
This guy on this little rinky-dink website is speaking truth to power. We've been averaging 600,000 views a day,
beating most of the cable shows in America.
We're the largest online news show in the world.
We're celebrating our 1 billionth view.
We're coming.
More politics ahead with Jack Uger.
He knew that the MSNBC opportunity was an experiment.
And fill in host beat CNN headline news goodbye. At some point, they want to give me a show.
Tells someone you're interviewing to shut up, that's when they raise the red flag.
That guy needed a call glass and shut up.
If President Obama's doing the wrong thing, I'm not going to tell you that he's doing the right thing so I can quote support him.
He says to me, you won't believe the meeting that I just had.
So the head of MSNBC talked to me.
And they want him off the air. Jake took an incredible risk. We're supposed to.
I don't think anyone else does it better. I don't think anyone's even close.
Before you know it, I'll be back on your TV doing an actual show. I guarantee it.
Okay.
I feel like music and porn is so distracting. It shouldn't exist.
Yeah. The thing I can't stand is the fake moaning. Like, is anybody convinced though, like, oh, she's really into it? Like, it's just, that's like, I got it, Bring it down. You're at a 10, you need to be at a 2. Okay, so, by the way, we showed you a clip during the break if you're watching the show live of Eric Myler at a biker rally that turned into a Trump rally, basically. Really interesting. I like how the woman was so flummoxed when Eric asked, so do you know Donald Trump is an American? She's like, what do you mean, of course? Right? Why is Barack Obama not an of course, but Donald Trump is an of course? Let me try to think about that. Okay. So, catch a lot more of those clips. There's a lot of great clips from Eric and Jordan and Jimmy Dore as well. They're now covering both Bernie and Trump rallies in California as we speak, and in New Mexico as well. So all that is at youtube.com/TYTpolitics. Now a couple of tweets for you guys. Sheridan writes in, sick with the flu, but still watching TYT live. Got to get my TYT fix, even when I'm ill. Love you guys. Sheridan, I would argue, especially when you're sick. It's, you're sick, you ain't got shit to do, okay? And watch the Young Turks. But thank you for doing that. We appreciate it. And hashtag TYT live to talk to us throughout the show on Twitter. Tom Sherry writes, CNN are so smug deep inside their bubble that they ignore and are confused about Bernie's success. And then John Blackman writes in finally, so the corporate media vetted the corporate media and found everything above board. Good, I can turn on CNN again. Lead me. I like that, Andy. Okay, Casper's here with all the fascinating and sometimes stunning news.
Always stunning news.
All right, so let's do it.
That's what I bring to the show.
That's right.
Stunning. Okay. All right. The big story over the weekend was the fact that the Cincinnati Zoo had to shoot and kill a 450-pound silverback gorilla because of the fact that a four-year-old child went through the barrier and fell into a... basically showing you why the zoo felt the need to shoot the gorilla. However, there's a lot of controversy around their decision to do so. I want to warn you that the video is difficult to watch, but with that said, let's take a look and we'll continue discussing as we watch this for B-roll. So you look at this video and right there in the corner you see the gorilla. You don't see the child yet, but you will in a minute. You're watching him drag the kid as people are screaming as they're watching this, by the way, which further irritated the gorilla and probably led him to continue dragging the kid.
Yeah, now the gorilla's name is Harambe, and now there are groups that are calling themselves Justice for Harambe. There's been other instances where gorillas have actually protected kids that fell into... the kid, and if they're screaming around, the gorilla might be more spooked.
Right.
Now, of course, one of the questions is, could they have shot him with a tranquilizer dart instead?
So, the zoo is saying that that was not an option, considering the fact that the group... So,
yeah, absolutely.
No matter what they do, they were going to get criticized. And it's a tragedy that this, you know, animal was shot and killed as a result of what happened, but you have to kind of do a cost-benefit analysis in that moment. And so, I don't begrudge them for making the decision that they did. If I were in their position, I would probably make the same decision because you're talking about a human life that's at danger, right? In fact, Thane Maynard, who is the Cincinnati Zoo's director, says, looking back, the barriers exceed any required protocols. The trouble with barriers is that whatever the barrier, some people can get past it. No, the zoo is not negligent. However, there is some indication that after an inspection of the zoo previously, or prior to this happening, they found that there wasn't adequate measures taken to ensure that people wouldn't, you know, get past.
actual bullets and killed them. So I want to do a poll on our app. If you don't have the TYT app yet, it's very easy to get. Go to the App Store, just type in TYT, you'll get it. But we don't do the polls unless we're super genuinely curious which side you guys go.
Petition asking for, or demanding, I should say, for the parents to be held responsible for this. Look, and there's also a lot of judgment being thrown around, right? Like, the mother is being blamed for this. We're about to show you a
Jesus Christ.
It's disgusting. And so, look, I get it. Parents should be very aware of where their kids are, and they should do everything they can to watch over them. But you're dealing with a four-year-old boy. Four-year-old boys can be rambunctious. Accidents happen. To place all the blame on the parents and demonize them like that, I don't think is the right way to go about it either. Yes, it's a tragedy.
So I'm going to get to my opinion on that in a second. Let's watch the Fox News clip, and then I'll tell you what I think I would have done under some circumstances.
And according to the Daily Mail, the father has a long rap sheet including drugs and kidnapping charges. In 2006, he was sentenced to a year behind bars, and protesters and animal lovers have been standing outside of the zoo calling for the parents to be prosecuted. A Cincinnati police... Now, some saying the parents need to be charged, bringing up the dad's past criminal history, who wasn't even there at the zoo at the time. The mom is in the background. You can hear her yelling if you listen closely, saying, mom is up here, mom is here, and someone else is yelling, we're praying for you, Jesus or God be with this child. So you have all that commotion. What's your message for the parents?
You know, it's kind of a wake-up call in the sense that, you know, you could take your child to a home improvement store and say, I mean, Home Improvement show is here explaining the dangers within that. So you've got to watch your children. There's just a million different ways that if you're not watching your child, the child can get in the trouble.
Okay, I was wondering when you said, because I hadn't seen the video, why they were going to go after the dad who wasn't even there, right? And I was going to kiddingly say, where are the fathers? They say that about black people. Because I didn't realize the kid was black. When I saw the video, it's too far... I assumed it was a white kid, right? Like, why is Fox News on this? Then they show the picture of the parents, and I'm like, of course they're gonna blame the parents. Now, a lot of people are blaming the mom, but blaming the dad.
He wasn't even there. I mean, that's the incredible thing. They're bringing up his past, which, by the way, he turned his life around. He's now like a productive member of society. He's a good father to his children. But none of that matters, right? Doesn't matter that he wasn't there,
because no matter what story happens, black people are at fault, right? And then they say the other side racializes issues. How in the world did this get racial? Okay, anyway, all right, let's get back to reality and not the insane world of Fox News. Look, if I'm the parent on the scene, here's what I ask the zoo to do immediately, okay? And by the way, they react, and then they would explain to me, he's already disoriented, he's already mad, he's already dragged the kid around, and the tranquilizer dart takes at least 90 seconds, maybe more, to work. And then they would suggest, as they did here, no, we think we should take a live shot, right? It's my four-year-old, I don't care how he got down there, take the shot, okay? And so look, you want to get angry at me? I hear you, okay? And you want to get angry at the parents or the zoo, or whatever, it sucks that the ape was killed. That's terrible that the gorilla was killed. And by the way, the guy who runs the zoo said, we're all devastated that this tragic accident resulted in the death of a critically endangered gorilla. We're all sick about it, right? Because most of us are caring, decent people who didn't want to see that poor animal get hurt because it wasn't his fault at all, right? But if it's your four-year-old kid down there, take the shot. I don't even think it's close.
Yeah.
So now if you don't have a four-year-old kid and you haven't seen a 4-year-old kid climb around in a second while you're not looking, super easy to turn around and go, or maybe you do have one, but you think you're holier than thou. Oh, I will judge you. I will judge all the other parents, right? And I'll judge the zoo, and I'll judge everybody else. But, you know, because it wasn't my kid, so what do I care?
So let's talk about that just for a quick second, because I think that it's important. I can't stand the judges that are always on their kids and always watching them every moment. Accidents do happen. When I was 2 years old, I fell in a pool, okay? In our backyard, I fell in the pool in the deep end. Luckily, nothing happened to me because I somehow grabbed onto the edge of the pool until my parents came and rescued me, right? My mom is on me, even as an adult, constantly. Because I gotta call her every day, gotta tell her where I'm at. My mom is the definition of, you know, a helicopter mother, right? Even given that, even given how closely she watched me, that accident happened, okay? Parents make mistakes, accidents happen, it's really difficult to be a parent. It is tragic that this animal had to be shot and killed, but at the same time, everybody take a step back and reflect on your own lives before you're so judgmental about someone else.
So there's only about 175,000 of these western lowland gorillas that are left in the world, according to the International Union for Conservation of Nature. And then this sparked a conversation about should they be zoos in the first, should they be in the zoo in the first place? I like how people just are shocked and chagrined to find out that we keep animals in cages in zoos. Look, I've been saying this for years upon years on the Young Turks. Like, look, zoos have upsides, but they also have big downsides. So we've been consistent on this from day one. Keeping those poor animals in those cages has got serious ethical issues, no matter what your good intentions are. And sometimes, like, they're about to break through the glasses happen in one case, and then tells of that. But and one of the reasons that they keep these particular gorillas in captivity is because it's called a species survival program. They want to make sure that if we kill them too much or their surroundings are too limited, partly again due to man-made conditions, that if they die in the wild, we at least have these that are in captivity as an insurance policy. So it's a complicated issue with upsides and downsides, but some people only see black and white, well, in the case of Fox News, literally, right? And are ready to jump in there with a definitive opinion. I think it's a super hard situation and a tragedy all around. But I'm just being honest with you. If it's my kid, I act, and I act right away. So,
same way.
And by the way, I mean, I'll take any consequences. Like, hey, you want to put, make that a crime and you want to put it on me? Yeah, whatever. Take the shot, okay? I'd rather go to jail than have that. The kid already got a concussion from what happened, right? Let alone the scratches, all that stuff. Rather than risk my kid's life. That makes me a bad guy? Okay, fine. I'll take it. I'm a bad guy. But take the shot, because no way I'm risking my kid's life. Okay. Just quick, because... Well, let me ask on behalf of Fox News JR, where are the fathers?
Again, you hear that part, you know where that was going. I was reading up a little bit on, well, first of all, yes, I mean, everyone feels bad about the animal dying. But again, it's another one of those instances where if it's your kid, you're all about taking care of it. Oh my God, we gotta save my kid. And of course, we get that, it's your kid. But people who are detached and separated from this kid, they'll be like, man, that kid shouldn't have been in there. I'm sure there's going to be that. There's going to be a certain percentage of people who say that. But when it's yours, okay, you want that to happen your way. So it should be across the board. And secondly, there's experts, people, everyone, I saw someone say, everybody's an expert on gorilla behavior now.
Yeah.
You know, gorillas actually, you know, there's a certain percentage of them that like to care for a kid when he falls. And we've seen that happen. I've seen it once. Yeah. Everybody's seen that story. How much he had eaten? How much he hadn't eaten? Did he just wake up? All this stuff, who knows? But also, so in that thought, what Jack Hanna and Jeff Corwin both said, those animal, wild animal guys that appear on every night show that everyone thinks is an expert, because we trust them, because they're on TV, they both said they agreed with the zoo's decision, but also were like, I can't believe the mother. Let her kid get far enough away from her to even get in that situation, which is a normal reaction. You don't have to be the guy who brings the monkeys on the Tonight Show to to realize that. But that's their thing, and I wonder what how many people read that or saw that their reaction was that and said, oh, maybe it was okay. We have to listen to people sometimes instead of just listening to ourselves. It's normal. I mean, yeah, everybody feels bad. No one wants to see that happen. Yeah. But also, you know, these people that are killing wild animals in the wild and using them as trophies and holding their heads up. I mean, you know, these endangered species, no, they're going, you know, these are hunters. They can hunt.
So. Yeah, that is a funny contrast. I love that. Whenever it's a hunter, Fox News jumps out to defend him and go, yeah, like, ah, we got, that's fine, man. It's just being a man and killing him with a rifle. Okay, when you do it to protect your kids, they're like, what kind of a monster would do this? Where are the fathers? Jesus, okay. Jesus, do you take the shot?
Yeah, just like you said, why I take the risk of being arrested as a bad parent, perceived as a bad parent, whatever. Like, save my kids for sorry.
Yeah. And now, Joy, my daughter is closer to 4 years old than.
Oh my God, she's almost four.
I know,
insane.
Right? Yeah. So, if she's down there, she is scared beyond imagination, mm-hmm. right? And we've done all the chimp stories where they reap.
Gonna be like, you know, let's take the risk and use a tranquilizer dart that will take about 10 minutes to kick in. No parent is gonna be in favor of that.
And by the way, nice shooting too, because I'd be scared to death as they were taking the shot.
Yeah.
Right. So nobody's happy about the gorilla dying. The least culpable is the gorilla, right?
Yeah.
But nonetheless, you got to do what you got to do. And
Japanese boy is lost in the woods after his parents decided to abandon him as punishment because he was being too rambunctious. Now, the 7-year-old boy has been missing for more than 2 days in a mountainous region of Japan. His name is Yamato. So, Tanuka, please, because it meant that he would have to be honest about the reason why the 7-year-old boy was missing. But eventually he decided contacting the authorities was the right thing to do, and now they're searching for the boy, but he's yet to be found. This part of Japan is known to have bears, so they're very concerned that the child won't survive being lost like this. But we'll see how it plays out.
Okay, Jesus Christ. Now, look, this is... So, now I know as a parent, people get frustrated. I've got this son is almost 6. This kid was 7. He was throwing rocks at cars. And they're trying to be good parents, teach them a lesson, don't do that. You want to walk away for a second in the woods, I'd be a little scared at a mall, I'd be a little scared at your house. Okay, right? That's fine. At a park where you can clearly see them out of the corner of your eye. Okay, in the middle of the jungle. Even if there's no wild bears, which in this case there are, right? It's the ones the kid can get scared, hide under a rock, and then he's been missing for 2 days now.
I mean, like, the worst my parents did to punish me or scare me was threatening to call the police when I was being bad. I don't know if your parents ever did that, but police mm-hmm. could catch him, and I'd be like, oh. Shit, I better be careful. The cops are going to come arrest me. Right? Which later led to my fear of cops in general.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, if you grow up thinking the cops are, like, the worst and you should fear them, of course you're going to grow up fearing them.
No wonder you do all those police abuses.
Yeah, exactly.
So, look, I think everybody agrees it's not a hard decision, terrible decision here to leave the kid alone in the woods. Please find him. Now they got 150 people searching for him. And that kid out bears, and none of that happens to him, right? But just since it's 2 days, that also means at least one night, maybe two nights. Imagine how scared he is in the middle of the night.
I can't even imagine how scared we would be in the middle of the woods, lost in the middle of the night.
Yeah, right? And let alone a 7-year-old boy. Please find him.
All right, moving on. And switching gears to something different. The History Channel is launching a four-part miniseries of Roots, a modern version of it, and there's one public figure that isn't too happy about this relaunch. It's Snoop Dogg. In fact, he believes that this does more harm than good for the black community. Take a look at a post that he put up on Instagram explaining why.
No disrespect, but I can't watch no motherfucking more black movies where niggas getting dogged out. 12 years of slave, Roots, Underground. I can't watch none of that shit. Sick of this shit. How the fuck they gonna put Roots on Memorial Day? They gonna just keep beating that shit in our heads of how they did us, huh? I mean, I don't understand America. They just want to just keep showing the abuse that we took hundreds and hundreds of years ago. But guess what? We're taking the same abuse. Think about that part. When y'all gonna make a motherfucking series about the success that black folks is having? The only success we have is Roots and 12 Years a Slave and shit like that, huh? Fuck y'all, I ain't watching that shit. I advise you motherfuckers that's real niggas like myself, fuck them television shows. Let's create our own shit based on the day. How we live and how we inspire people today. Black is what's real. Fuck that old shit. Right, Jules?
Okay. Well, he does keep it real.
Yeah.
You know, even credit for that.
I love anyone
who make a racial argument against Roots. I'm not sure I would have used the N-word. But that's Snoop's decision, not my decision, right? It borders on the ironic. But in it, I understand his frustration. I think his anger is a little misdirected, so I don't agree with him. But if you're a black man in America, I can see how it wears on you, right? How many of these enslaved, etc., it wears on your soul, right? And I think that's his frustration coming out. At the same time, it is part of our history, and most people want to ignore that history, and I think it's actually a good thing to show it, and it doesn't help to hide it.
So you have to consider the fact that in states like Texas, the Board of Education is doing everything it can to whitewash history books and social study books to ensure that civil rights leaders aren't represented, to ensure that conservative values are overrepresented. And so we're dealing with that. And we're also dealing with the fact that there's a huge population of people in this country right now that either don't know the realities of what black people had to deal with in this country, or if they do know, you're right, they want to brush it under the rug or pretend like it didn't exist. They want to whitewash it themselves. And so I see an importance of having him in that a lot of shows on television, and I'm not talking about sitcoms and things like that, I'm talking about, you know, non-fiction type shows, don't really focus on the successes of black people. Right? I think that that is underrepresented. And so I understand his frustrations in that. And look, we were talking about this in the production meeting, and Ben disagreed with me, and he brought up shows like Blackish, right? And not to bring him up because he can't really defend himself. But
and Empire and Scandal.
Right. But those are black people today who are succeeding, who don't get any love in the press, who don't get any attention in the press. I get it. And the reason why a show like Blackish is doing so well is because it pokes fun at all the stereotypes the black community has to deal with, right? It's about a successful black family kind of raising awareness about all these issues that black people have to deal with because of the stereotypes.
But I'm not sure there's a lot of nonfiction shows about successful white folks.
Really?
I mean, I don't. Maybe I'm wrong about that. I mean, obviously there was one called, you know, The Apprentice, where so-called successful white man fires everybody.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I see you. I hear you on that. But, look, Ben also went on to say that Roots, the original Roots, when he was growing up, shaped a lot of his worldview and part of what made him a liberal. And that's not a bad thing. That's a good thing.
I know Dog's frustration when he says that he doesn't feel like the good things that black people are doing today are being covered or represented in the media.
All right, well, then let's go to a successful black man right now in the studio who's going to adjudicate this for us. Snoop Dogg, right or wrong, J.R. Jackson, go.
Yeah, sure he's right. I mean, again, it can give you both sides. He's not going to watch it as cool, and he's trying to tell all the rest of his real motherfuckers not to watch it either, right? That's true. We have to have other things done. I was, I ran into this guy months ago in the grocery store who was very much associated with the older Black Panther Party, the Black Panther Party that no one knew about, that no one seems to know about. And he was frustrated that the only thing that's always taught and talked about and really portrayed is the peaceful protests and the way things were done with Black folks in the civil rights era. He's like, you know what, that's cool, because that's what happened. But no one knows about how some people were like, no, no, we're fighting back. And they won a lot of battles. Now, that's his perspective. He liked that part, because he's like, you know, we were getting attacked. And they kept wanting to say that we were just powering over and getting hung and getting beat and getting shot, getting ripped apart. He goes, no, no, we fought back. So he wanted that also to be portrayed, not to disparage what always gets said, but he wants both sides. But the worry is that it'll inspire people.
mouth to be like, yep.
Rights and judging the parents for this is a clear lack of empathy.
Wait, what? Blaming the parents like this is a clear lack of empathy?
Yes.
Yeah, that's what we're lacking as a nation. Empathy. It's incredible how, is it non-empathetic? Unempathetic we are?
No, I'd go with non, but non. I'm not positive either. Okay, Chris Carlson writes in, was that a veiled TOT Supreme Court that just happened? I missed those long time since we've seen the Chief Justice. Agreed. In fact, we were talking about that during the break. We've got to bring that back for you. That's our fault. Don't judge us. And then Eric Johnson says, only thing Snoop has ever said that I've agreed with him on, right on, homie, I ain't watched that shit either. Okay. Everybody's got their opinions. We move forward. Go.
All right. A U.S. district judge has ruled that the sealed documents involved in a Trump University case can be unsealed. Now, this is U.S. District Judge Gonzalo Curiel, and the reason why the press is covering this is because there seems to be a little bit of a catfight between Donald Trump and this judge. Now, the catfight, of course, was started by Donald Trump accusing him of being a Mexican judge that should be investigated because he's a disgrace. So let me give you some more details on what happened. And by the way, Trump made those statements prior to the judge making this ruling. In an order signed on Friday, U.S. District Judge Gonzalo Curiel said that materials, including Trump University procedures on dealing with students and the media, should be unsealed. Trump is fighting a lawsuit that accuses his school venture of misleading thousands of people who paid up to $35,000 for seminars to learn about the billionaire's real estate investment strategies. I should also note that he's currently facing three separate class action lawsuits for defrauding students. Now, here's what he had to say about the judge. I have a judge who is a hater of Donald Trump. A hater. He's a hater. Very eloquent.
Yeah.
By the way, he said these things at a rally in San Diego. He also says, we're in front of a very hostile judge. The judge was appointed by Barack Obama, Trump said, adding he believed Curiel was Mexican. The reality is, Curiel was born in Indiana, and he's an American.
So, I don't know if he knows this, but Mexicans can't be American judges. Okay, but I don't know if he means Mexican-American, and hence I hate him because he's Mexican-American. Although, I heard from Donald Trump that he loves Latinos and loves Mexicans. So,
oh, yeah,
he even eats their tacos. So, it's kind of weird that, he would question this guy just on the idea that he'd be Mexican. Of course he's not actually Mexican. There's no actual Russians or Mexicans serving as judges in America. I mean, there's plenty that are ethnically that like that, because we're a diverse country, but that's exactly what Donald Trump hates. So, look, there's two different stories here. One is Trump University, which is a mess. He's not winning with Trump University anymore. In fact, he was never winning with it. The minute anybody went through the program, they were like, but that's it? This is not a real university. And then New York was like, can't call it a university when it isn't a freaking university. Then he had to change his name because he was wrong on that legally. And then he gets sued by almost everybody who went to it, but many people who went to it sued him because they weren't winning with it.
There are three different lawsuits pending right now in regard to Trump University. And it isn't just that he misled students into believing that it was a university because it was called Trump University. He also lied in infomercials about it. He said that he had hand-selected or hand-picked instructors for the school, and then in a 2012 deposition, he testified that, no, he in fact did not hand-pick anyone for the school, not a single instructor. Students have testified or even written articles and pieces about how you would go, and they would immediately play on your fears and insecurities. They would talk about how no job is secure right now, and that everyone's going to be poor unless they buy real estate and they do this and do that. Gave them terrible advice. A lot of students took out $35,000 worth of student loans in order to go to these seminars that, again, were marketed as if they were classes from an accredited university. I mean, it was a scam. It was a straight-up scam.
His whole career is a scam. Like every single thing he does is a scam on top of a scam. Look, how would anyone know about real estate, a guy like Donald Trump, when they bankrupted four companies centered around real estate? Now, they make excuses for him now, his supporters do, and they say, oh, no, that was a savvy business move to go bankrupt, to take advantage of the laws that are available in America. You know what's a savvier business move? Not going bankrupt.
Yeah.
Just running a profitable business. Okay, he doesn't know a thing about real estate. All he knows is get my name out there and get paid for my name. Trump Steaks, Trump Water, Trump University. Right, and this is his whole presidential run is centered around that as well. But second issue is there's no excuses left anymore. He is obviously racist against Latinos, right? Yeah. Now, I know that the judge ruled against him, so he doesn't like the judge, right? And so you can attack the judge as an Obama appointed, that's perfectly fine. You can attack him for ruling against you, perfectly fine. But when you gratuitously bring up his background based on his name,
what's the point of bringing that up? I mean, the only reason why he's bringing that up is because he thinks the judge possibly being of Mexican descent is a negative thing. He sees it as a negative thing. And so he antagonizes him for possibly having a Mexican background. It's ridiculous. And by the way, another thing that Trump said, you know, during this rally was that he thinks the judge should be investigated. He was asked, okay, well, what do you think the judge should be investigated for? No idea. He should just be investigated. And that's the thing that drives me crazy. He makes statements like that, and his voters support him. There's no substance to his statements. There's no defense for what he did in scamming these students. He was asked why he antagonized the judge, and his answer was, because I don't care. That's not an answer. He's running for president. That's not an answer.
He has to answer a child gives. I don't care. What should he be? You should investigate him. Based on what? He was unfair to me. And he's Mexican. Actually, a child wouldn't say that last part, because hopefully you've taught your children better than that, right? So they'll say, no, he's bringing out that he's a Mexican because, you know...
Because he said racist things about Mexicans, and they're worried that the judge is retaliating for Trump saying racist things about Mexicans. Yeah, okay. Not really working with your argument.
Yeah, that's not a great defense for Trump. But wait a minute, I thought Trump said that the Mexicans love him. So why would they be biased against him? So by his own admission, you know, if you believe Donald Trump, which good luck to you in your life, if you believe Donald Trump, if the Mexicans love him, why would he bring up that he's Mexican? The only reason he'd bring it up is because he wants to bring up his race out of nowhere to say you shouldn't trust a Mexican, and or you shouldn't trust a Mexican because I've already said racist things against Mexicans.
Yeah. You know, Jake, you're like, you don't understand. Like, Trump says all the things that, like, we all want to say, but he has, like, the guts to say them. Get the fuck out of here. Like, that nothing drives me crazier than that stupid-ass argument. You know what? Then we can have a middle schooler be our next president, because middle schoolers say shit that they really mean.
No, right? But actually... to say
it.
So you like that you finally have someone running for president who is openly racist, and it thrills you that he gets to say the racist things that you're thinking. Wow, congratulations. Go ahead and vote for him based on that. You sound like a terrific person. Okay, vote.
All right. A Columbia University student was so fed up with her Ivy League life that she decided to run away from it. Now, to give you some context into this story, Nayla Kidd, who is a student in this story, was a star science student all her life, and she got a lot of positive reinforcement for doing so. She excelled in academics, and as a result, she made it to an Ivy League school, which she was elated about. She was super happy that she finally made it to Columbia. Now, she starts going to Columbia, and she realizes this pressure cooker environment is devastating, and it's making her miserable. So in a piece titled, Why I Had to Escape My Ivy League Life and Disappear, Kidd recounted how the school's pressure cooker environment led her to become increasingly ambivalent about her schoolwork. Here's what she said. I started to totally disconnect. I deleted my Facebook profile first, shut down my phone, and got a prepaid number, took all my money out of my Chase bank account, and opened a new one. Kidd wrote that she had no plans to return to school. Instead, she wants to make music and work on her writing and modeling careers. Now, this is the quote that, you know, really spoke to me. She says, I always told myself I needed to find gratification through academia, but now I want to find it on my own through the arts. I finally broke down because I was living a life I thought I should be living instead of living the life that I want. Now, she's getting a lot of criticism for this. People are saying, oh, cry me a river. You got into an Ivy League school and you have this privilege and you've totally squandered it. But I totally understand where she's coming from. And I think that the type of pressure that you have, not only when you're in college, but when you have, when you finally enter the job market and you're in your career, becomes devastating to a point where even if you're passionate about something to begin with, it makes you disconnect from it, and it makes you kind of reject it in some ways.
Not buying it.
No, I know you're not buying it, but I relate to her on a lot of levels, so okay. We'll get to that in a second.
All right, so, look, if I'm her parents, I'm furious. So, wait a minute. You got into I'm super proud of you, got into a good school, and you did what? You just shut down without talking to me about it?
Yeah.
And you decided that you were going to take all the money and go to Brooklyn and live with the hipsters and get into art? No, that requires a conversation before you take all the money and do all that stuff,
I mean,
right?
Like, it's almost as crazy as someone, you know, graduating from Columbia, getting a law degree, and then deciding, like, fuck being a lawyer. Fuck my high-paying job. I want to be a talk show host.
I don't know who you're talking about. So, but that goes to my point, Anna. We had a conversation, right? Now, admittedly, it was a one-sided conversation. This is the direction I'm going, right? But there was a lot of thank you for helping me to get into these schools and to afford the schools and all that, but you've got to trust me that going in this direction is what's better for me, and it was at the end, not in the middle, so there was a lot of differences, if you ask me. So, here I'm being an ass because I didn't feel that much pressure in school, and so maybe I'm having trouble relating. Like, I didn't think school was that big a deal.
Okay, but let me give you a little more context, because I feel like I'm not really doing her case justice, so let me explain. So, she is obviously a black student who's going to an Ivy League school with a bunch of wealthy white kids that she can't relate to. She leaves her family, she leaves her friends, she leaves everything she knows in order to go to the school. And I get it, a lot of people
That's
do
what
that.
You're doing.
A lot of people do it. But here's the thing. You also, like, enter this environment of school, 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 school. You gotta succeed, you gotta succeed. There's a tremendous amount of academic pressure, okay? You don't connect with anyone on campus, right? You're away from everyone that you love and the life that you had. And so, yeah, it becomes really difficult. And here's another thing. I actually admire the fact that she realized, yeah, engineering and what I'm doing right now with science at this Ivy League school is not what appeals to me. I love the arts. That's what I really want to do, but I've been lying to myself to appease everyone else around me. It takes, look, I don't like the way that she went about it in that she ran away and she didn't tell her mom what happened or what she was going through. You do need an open line of communication. I agree with you on that. But it also takes balls for her to do what she did. You know, some people see it as, oh, she dropped out of school, oh, she's a loser. No, it takes balls to be honest with yourself about what you actually love and want to do.
So, look, you've gone a long way in convincing me that that she certainly had a lot of courage in taking an untraveled path, or the path least traveled, right? And I, yes, I can relate to that, and I could appreciate that. And, yes, I've never been that person, so that's why I'm having trouble empathizing. So I remember my uncle yelled at me to not go to Penn. I went to Columbia for law school, to Penn for undergrad. And he's like, no, they will eat you alive! You cannot go to the less school! Less school!
Really?
Yeah.
Wow!
They are too smart! I'm like, what, so I'm a dummy? What? Like, what? And so you could make the argument that I was a minority of some sort, right? And all it's... And by the way, my roommate and a lot of the kids there had gone to really elite private schools. I'd gone to a public school, etc. Right? And I remember after the first semester or whatever thinking, this is what the private schools produce? Please. Okay? Hey, now, but I'm a different guy. I'm not her. Right?
Yeah.
And like when my uncle tells me that, I think, bring it.
I know.
Why I have the disconnect from her. But yes, stepping into her shoes, which is what we're supposed to do on the show, right?
Yeah.
I just wish she talked it through more. But then, you know, given that her parents are probably super supportive and that's how she was able to have the opportunity to get to Columbia, my guess, I'm just guessing, right? I know that was the case for me, is that they'll have her back. But you got to trust them enough to have that conversation. And just pulling the chute is not a constructive way of doing it. Although, and don't get me wrong, a lot of people dropped out from school, including Bill Gates, mm-hmm. Matt Damon, Zuckerberg, okay? They all dropped out of Harvard, and they're all okay. So sometimes in unique situations, it does make sense, but I'd really think it through, because you might not be Bill Gates.
Yeah, look, as long as she's happy, I feel like she's already made the right decision. But again, she should have went about it in a different way. I think we all agree on that. But also, another thing for you to take into consideration is that all her life, she was applauded and got positive reinforcement for one specific thing, and that was excelling in science, right? And if that becomes your core identity based on what other people want to identify you as, it's hard to deviate from that and say, you know what, I actually really don't like this field, and I don't want to get an education at this Ivy League school in engineering. So
that is a ton of pressure. Yeah. I will definitely grant you that.
Yeah.
Okay, JR, did you want to say something about it or no? No, you're past it? Okay. Look, I'll tell you a quick, super quick side story. For the brief time that I was somewhat practicing Muslim, because I'd taken that course in college, I was like, yeah, sure. I mean, I don't get up at 5 to pray or anything, but I'll pray once. But I'll pray 5 times within that one time that I pray. Like, all the bullshit, excuse me. But all the Turkish parents knew me as the one kid who didn't drink and stuff. They're like, oh, that is a good boy. Why are you not like him, right? And so when I realized, no, I don't believe this stuff, and I'm going to be agnostic, and I'm going to just say, no, it's go further and say it's actively wrong,
mm-hmm.
There was a ton of pressure. I felt like I was letting everyone down.
Yeah, exactly, and that's the worst feeling.
Yeah, and all the Turkish dads who were proud of me, now they find out I am drinking, and in fact, I've rejected Islam.
You're eating pork.
Right. And,
yeah.
And the reality is, none of them are really Muslim. They drink like fish. All those dads. I don't, not one of them doesn't drink,
yeah.
Right? Not one of them actually follows it, but it's like an identity thing. Oh, do what you mean? It is good. Yeah. How come you don't follow it? It is good anyway.
I feel like people people spend way too much time being concerned about the life decisions of others. How about you just mind your own business and live your life and let other people live theirs, right? This girl, or woman, I should say, deciding that she doesn't want to go to this school isn't impacting anyone else except for her. It's her life decision. Let's move on.
No, let's try. Okay, let's do one more story. I know it's late.
Really?
Yes, really. Let's do it.
Okay.
This one's easy.
It is easy, but we're going to have like a 20-minute conversation about it. All right,
go.
The Libertarian National Convention occurred over the weekend, and it was an exciting event, especially when one candidate by the name of James Weeks went up on stage and did a little show. Take a look.
See, who was right about not pushing it, right? All right, guys, what do we think? Do we have that video? Can we make it happen? It's not working. Sad day. Okay, he's stripped naked. You probably saw it somewhere else.
Can we go to my one shot? Maybe you guys can see his picture.
Okay.
Look at that guy.
Yeah. All right. The reason I wanted to do the story is I just want to make a quick point. Libertarians, I defended you in the first half. Don't do that. Like they're already not going to take you seriously.
Mm-hmm.
I know it wasn't all libertarians, it was just that one guy. But boy, you guys should be pissed at him. Because now he's allowed all the media who wanted to dismiss you to dismiss you and go, oh, they got a naked guy.
Yeah, you're right. I want to dismiss libertarians, so this helped me dismiss them even further.
And we were going to do barely... Since he's bare,
yeah.
It was going to be good.
We fucked it up, man.
Sad day for us. All right, anyways, we're out of time. But post-game's coming up. So Anna's going to tell you about her trip,
mm-hmm.
if you will. All right, and much more. Bye-bye.